She has won many awards for her great performance in Tata. She has cleared 12 papers of actuarial science. She has an experience of working in statutory valuation and shareholder reporting. Currently, she is senior executive in Tata AIA. Today, she will be sharing her journey with us. She will talk about how to network using LinkedIn and also share some great insights about the life insurance domain. All of you must keep your cameras on and mic off. You all can ask the questions by first raising your hands, and then we will allow you to turn on your mics. Please make the session interactive. I'm sorry, she is a BBA graduate from St. Xavier's College, Kolkata. The podium is all yours, Ma'am Rashi.
Yeah, so hello everyone. A very good morning to each one of you. It's already mentioned, I'm going to talk about the topics how to network using LinkedIn and insights on life insurance domain. I first thought of starting with my introduction, I think, but it's already given that I've graduated from St. Xavier's, Kolkata. I did my BBA honors from there. Along with my graduation, I started pursuing actuarial science. I have cleared 12 papers till date, which is as per the old curriculum. And just after my graduation, I started with internship in Tata AIA. And it was in the statutory evaluation team where I interned for 3 months, and then I got a permanent role. I worked in the statutory evaluation team for roughly 3 years, and then I moved to the shareholder reporting team where I worked in business planning, and then I moved to the VONP team, which is valuation of new business. I'll explain what the actuaries do in each of these team going ahead, like in the future, in the coming few minutes. And so briefly, this is about my role currently in Tata. I'm awaiting for result of two of my papers. Regarding my actuarial achievements, like I cleared three papers in one attempt of September 19 diet, I guess. September 19 diet, all in first attempt. And I've received multiple awards in Tata for my good performance. So that's about it, I guess. And let's start the session. So I'll first start with the LinkedIn part, where I'll give you all some networking tips which can really help you in your career growth. As freshers, I think you should use LinkedIn as a platform which can enhance your CV, I'll say, because gone are those days when we used to just focus on CVs. These days, people give a lot of weightage to your LinkedIn profile, and it's really LinkedIn is very beneficial, not just for professionals but also for students who want to stand out in their course. When I say it's good for students, also you all, it's not just for the job purpose that you want to get a job or internship in any domain in actuarial profile and you just approach people that please refer my CV. You should also use it as a platform to get yourself up to date about what's happening in the industry. Hello. So I'll explain how you can use LinkedIn to go a step ahead and stand out in your course compared to other students. And you can connect with maybe other students who are giving same papers, and maybe discuss ideas. And you should not just focus on clearing papers just for the sake of having a degree. You should also add value to yourself and understand the concepts very thoroughly. And maybe you can follow many LinkedIn profiles or pages of institutes or like the tuition centers, the coaching institute pages, and maybe, you know, also the professionals. There are profiles which are really good of the professional people who are working currently and who are at a very good level in the actuarial domain. And maybe you can try to connect with those people. You can consider LinkedIn as an online version of your community. Like when I say your community over here, I think most of you are actuarial students. So it's an online version of our actuarial community. You can consider it that segment of it. And so one tip over here, I'll give to each one of you. Please, please, please do maintain professional image on LinkedIn. It, you know, doesn't really look good when you don't have a professional image. Like there are people who post certain jokes on actuarial on LinkedIn. So first thing is, please avoid those things, and you have to maintain a professional image. Then secondly, you should follow or join pages or people related to actuarial, whether it be, as I mentioned, tuition groups or institute pages, or recognize people of the industry, engage with them, interact in the news feed professionally, or like, yeah, again, professionally, not, you know, in a joking manner, discussing, making fun out of it and all. Do ensure that it is professionally. The reason why I'm saying this, interaction is necessary because LinkedIn has very strong discoverability. You should post and comments, your posts and comments reach out the targeted audience. Like if you engage in the right manner, you can, you know, easily reach out to the people who can help you in your career, help you in your growth. So maybe you can use take the help of hashtags, or when you post, you can add multiple tags which are related to the post and related to your profession, and tag the appropriate people on your posts and comments. And when I say interact in the news feed, that's a very good way to, you know, make yourself recognized by people and make that visibility in others' eyes. And the reason why I'm more emphasizing on the tags and hashtags and tagging people is that LinkedIn gives you suggestions based on your activities, like based on your tags or the people you follow, based on your hashtags. It gives you suggestions, and like as I said, based on your based on the people you follow, it gives you suggestions of people whom you can follow. So yeah, you should make the most out of it. And coming to how to connect with people on LinkedIn, I know like it's really difficult to get your request accepted in the first place. Like tell me, out of you all, how many of you have been ghosted by people? You have sent the request and not received any response from you all. You can just raise your hand over here. I'm waiting for more. I can just see five, I guess. Strange, yeah, but nice. So only six of you all have been ghosted, which is really good. I think the count is very less, because I remember when I was a fresher, when I just graduated from college, I was trying to apply for internship or say a permanent role in the community, in the natural industry. I used to send invite to many people. Okay, fortunately, even if I got the connection request accepted, many a times I did not get any response from people if I asked them to share my CV. So yeah, you guys are really fortunate enough, I'll say, if it's just six of you. Anyways, starting with like how to connect. I think before you connect, very important thing is to have your account up to date. Like you need to ensure that there's nothing which you have missed out. You should have a very attractive bio describing you, your profile, like what you're currently doing and what are your achievements. It should be short and precise. Trust me, like no one is willing to read lengthy bios or lengthy description about you or what are your achievements. It should be very short and precise. Otherwise, people just skip it. So do ensure that your bio is very attractive and short and precise. So this is another takeaway. Do really spend time thinking about your bio. If you have work experience, please do add it. However small time period or the internship or the work experience was, or in whatever domain, please do mention about it, because you know, it adds a lot to your profile. Like when we hire or anyone in the industry for that matter hires, we try to, you know, find people who have some experience, because irrespective of it, whether it's actuarial or not, if you have any experience out other than actuarial also, it gives us some confidence that you know, the person has that work experience, he has worked in a professional environment and must have some basic idea of how the professional world works, or some IT skills, like, you know, basic Excels and all, or must have hands-on on these IT softwares and all. So that gives a really good value addition to your profile. And these days, like, you guys are really fortunate, I'll say, because you can you have the option of online internships. So even while you're working in college or just graduated, if you were earlier unable to move out for any particular profile or any role, now you can just work online and have the opportunity online. So that's a really value addition. You know, you should not just focus on having, like, if you're not getting any actuarial profile, any internship or job opportunity in actuarial, I suggest start with something related to it that can help you out going ahead. And say if you want to work in a life insurance, or say if you want to work in a general insurance but you're not able to get the internship or work experience of that particular domain, you know, you should try to get whatever alternative opportunity you get, and maybe eventually you can move out. So that's about it about adding work experience to your profile. Next is endorsements. If you guys are not aware of it, if you have skills which you are good at, you can ask people to endorse you. So you can ask your teachers, mentors, or, you know, seniors to endorse you for any skills which you think you are good at, or they think you are really good at. They should endorse you, and if they can write testimonials on it, nothing better than that. And so these things can really help you update your CV or build it better. No one really likes to, you know, go through a blank CV. That gives a very blank idea that what the person is and what skills the person has. And that might create doubt when the person is, you know, thinking of hiring you. So once you have the profile ready, only then I'll say go and approach people or send people requests. Because if you think your profile is not up to date, then you should yourself, you yourself will not be confident, and you will not be confident and think about others. How confident will the other person be to accept requests of a person who doesn't have anything on his profile? So yeah, do update your profile and then approach people. Do show curiosity, and, you know, the way you approach people is also very important. Like, you have to show curiosity and prioritize the other person. Make the other person realize that you value their time, because, you know, otherwise people don't really like it that just getting a request, or I'll say there are multiple times when you get CVs or like, please refer me for this role, or can you please forward my CV for any internship opportunity in your company. So these don't really give very good impression because you don't know the person. You know, he or she is a very random person, and just even if you accepted the request, you are just getting a message from that person to forward the CV. So I'll suggest better show that interest first, learn like what the profile is and learn about the person whom you're talking to or whom you're asking to share your CV. And like this is I think I'll say this is really important, you know. I think I'll ask you all, like the freshers, to stop just sharing our CVs. First, try to approach the person in a suitable manner. Again, value the other person's time because we all are professionals. You like 6 months, six of you have already mentioned that you have been ghosted. So not everyone has time. So if you you know just forward the CV and all, it's not really necessary that you'll get a response. So firstly, like it's not necessary you'll get your request approved in the first place. And like this is from my experience, I'll say like what really helped me in communicating with others or interacting with others on LinkedIn was the way I approached the people. There's this option on LinkedIn where you can customize your request. You can drop a message while you send a request and email message or something like that, where you can tell the person, like you can describe how you know about the person, like mention how you know the person and why you are messaging the person, what is your area of interest. And maybe instead you can just ask the person for first guidance, like can you guide me in this area, and that might show the other person that you're curious. And again, that will just avoid that impression that you're desperate to get a job or internship. So please do avoid it. And even if it's not just for a time delay, you should also, like, this is required because even if the person might not forward your CV, but he or she might give you some good suggestions which might help you to connect with someone else, or maybe guide you to the right person whom you can talk to. So it's really important that you interact with the person, build that relationship with the other person, and avoid getting ghosted. And like mentioning reason will also increase the chances of getting a reward, because I know when I open my LinkedIn and I check my requests, like there are some requests which have those customized messages, and there's very less chance that those messages will be unseen. And I do end up accepting most of them. So it really adds value to your request and makes the other person know about you. That's really important. You have to build a connection, and it's not just for the namesake. The person is supposed to know you. So break that ice, interact with the people seeking for their guidance. And if you get a positive response from the other side, please keep the conversation going. It will help you in the long run. If it's not just for the CV purpose, like forwarding your CV, you will get some guidance for some matter, and maybe you get connected to some other person who might end up helping you out. And at the end of the conversation, please do thank that person for their time. That gives a positive image that you value that person. So yeah, these are like the primary takeaways which I think you guys should have, like from this part of the session where I try to give you most of the tips for LinkedIn. I'll leave the forum open to you all if you have any queries on this part of the session. I can see two hands. Maybe Naveed wants to ask any question.
Hello, ma'am. Can you hear me? I'm Ritam.
Yeah, I can
Yeah,
hear
I
you,
wanted to
Rita.
ask you something. There is an option in LinkedIn known as open to work, so that gives the profile a dimension that I'm open to work. So does that thing work? I mean, I turned it on, but I don't think it works, ma'am. But can you give me an insight about that? Basically, it's a
So,
badge.
sorry.
It's a type of badge that I am open to work. It comes around the icon of my LinkedIn profile. So will it work?
I think there's no harm switching it on, but Like as you mentioned that you have switched it on, but you don't get any response or you haven't seen any update after it. I think the problem here is the reachability, because you know you guys are fresher. You all are looking for opening like the fresher role, maybe mostly in a actual profile you will get internship. And the problem here is when we are looking for interns, we you know we try to approach like. If we get any request from any person, you know, that gives a value addition because we know this person is actively looking for an internship. And as I mentioned, it's the interaction is very necessary. So you get to know the person, what his or her interests are. And that really gives a comfort to the other person. If we don't know you, if even if you have switched your badge on, there are many, you must have seen like there must be many people who would have their badges on, like this option on. The thing is how much comfort the other person has on that profile. So over here, I know referral is a you know it's not really good to have referrals, but over here I'll say ki referrals do matter. If you have again, yeah, one more addition to what I said earlier is when you interact with people, like when you send the person request, if he or she doesn't accept it, maybe you know go through other route. If there's any common person in the connection, maybe ask that person to introduce you and follow up with, because I don't really think for internship position at least these batches are very useful. What is more useful is that you keep following up. If there is any particular company in which you want to work, do keep following up with the particular with the employees in the actual profile of that particular company. Maybe you know you can search for say actually in that particular company, see the designations if you know which work in that company. So look for actuarial and those designations with the company name in the search box and try approaching those people. Don't you know keep bugging them, that is really not good, but keep following up in a polite manner. And yeah, I think that is more beneficial compared to the option you just mentioned.
Ma'am, you said about designation. Can you please tell me the few types of designation for which I will approach, suppose senior executive or hiring manager? What are the designation that I should target as a fresher?
So actually designation varies quite a lot from company to company. Not every company has same designation levels, same hierarchies. So if you have interest in say a particular company, you should try to approach your seniors. I'll say if you know anyone working there, even if you get to know one person, ask them about it. So just for example, if in my company you people like say that you can approach the HRs also, or say actual people also, actual professionals. I think the major role over here for internship in actuarial is of the actuarial profile. So maybe, you know, search for the head of actuary, just type actuary and the company name, that will help. And you'll get a list of all the employees of that company in the actuarial profile. So maybe interact with one and try to know with that respective person, who will be the appropriate person. There's no definite designation as such. Maybe ask that person only. Yeah. I hope I answered your question.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
Anyone else?
Yeah, I had a question.
Go ahead.
Yeah, so you talked about the conversation has to keep going on and we have to keep building up the professional relationship. But how do you actually do that? Because sometimes what happens is even in a conversation, after some conversation, they can also ghost you after that too, which is what has happened with me. So how do you actually make the conversation keep going and actually convert a initial conversation to actually getting something like a referral or something like that?
I think the major role here is the way you communicate. You should not, sound desperate or show that you're just desperate for the sake of getting the internship or the actual job. You should seek for guidance, maybe. The way you approach the person, again, valuing the other person's time is very important. So, and valuing other person also, that really makes the other person show interest. So, better, try to first search about the person. Think, look at what areas he or she has worked in, and maybe discuss those that I'm interested in this profile. Can you please help me? Can you please guide me? How do I prepare myself for say internship or job in that area? And then maybe eventually that person, if he or she replies, then help go ahead with the conversation. And if you see that the conversation is not going strong, then maybe you should try to get it as a closure, like there's no further follow-up to the person. So yeah, I think showing interest is the primary way you can keep the conversation going, and how you should also put the effort. You should do the homework before you try to approach the person. You should know about the person, right? So do some background check. Yeah, that's all.
Can you actually give some examples of such thing? Because I guess what has happened is, for example, you ask a certain question that a particular person is working in a certain company, and we ask a question, but usually what happens is they feel like it's a very general question, that it's a very broad question. So how do we actually be then specific? Because when we actually be specific, it's something like, for example, is this company something better than this company? So they would be much more diplomatic in the specific question. So how do we actually question that so that
That's obvious. The profession, when you are planning to work in a professional work in a job environment, you have to learn how to be diplomatic, and you can't really ask the other person which company is better than the other. This doesn't really sound good, and definitely this was not the correct question to ask, I'll say. And when you say you ask generic questions, and when I said that do your homework. You have many people, you have friends working in actuarial, you have some of your seniors working in actuarial. Try to approach them first, get your basic queries sorted out with them, and then try to have a mature conversation with the senior person whom you're trying to approach on LinkedIn. So yeah, first please do your homework before approaching the person. Anyone else?
Ma'am, I have a doubt. Like when we ask our teachers or seniors for testimonials, is it better that we write it and send to them so they find it easier to post, or should we ask them only? Because sometimes teachers say that you should only write.
See, it depends. Basically, it's supposed to be an honest response, right? Like if someone finds you fit for a certain skill, he or she should write it ideally. Given that everyone is busy and everyone wants the work to be done by the other person, you might be in a situation where the other person wants you to write it and just post it just for the sake of it. Do you think it's morally correct, you writing some good about yourself, which you think is correct, which you think you're good at, but might not be necessary that the other person thinks the same, right? So in order
True.
to get the other person's opinion, it's better to ask them to write it. If they can take out the time, then that's really good. That will give a correct picture of you. So I think it's preferred for sure.
Thank you.
So should I start with the second segment of this session, which is insights on life insurance domain? If you guys have any further queries, or maybe we can connect later this session, and maybe we can connect on LinkedIn. So do let me know if you have any further queries, or do reach out to Praveen or Shivangi. We can connect later. I'll start with the second part of this session. So, coming to insights on life insurance domain, I expect you all to have some basic idea of insurance and the types of products we already have. You must have studied in CT5. If you have any doubts, you can refer back to your CT5 book for sure. I'll anyways brief you about some of them. So, life insurance products are designed to meet personal financial needs, and the needs over here varies from person's lifetime and over calendar time. Like over the years, the needs varies. And like in India, life insurance is the traditional one, and it's one of the largest area of practice. And I have work experience in life insurance, and the topic is, so I'll start with the types of life insurance products. Basic one, it's the term assurance, where the benefits are paid on death of a life assured, provided it occurs within a certain time period. It's the time is selected at the time of purchase of policy. And usually in term assurance, no withdrawal benefit is given. Next is whole life assurance. It's similar to term assurance, just that the tenure part in term assurance, I said that the benefits are like when the death occurs within the time selected, the benefit is paid out. Whereas in whole life assurance, benefit on death of life insured is provided whenever it might occur over the whole lifetime of the policy holder. Third is pure endowment. I'll explain pure endowment and endowment assurance together. So, pure endowment is it provides benefits on survival to a known date, and so this is. It operates as a saving vehicle, where term assurance and whole life assurance was pure protection products. They were protection products. Endowment comes to saving part of the it has saving feature, and this was pure endowment, which had only survival benefit. When we say endowment assurance, we have both the features. It provides significant benefit on death as well as survival. So at maturity also, you get the benefit. So it has both protection feature as well as survival or saving vehicle, saving feature. Then you have features like options in your term assurance, like you might have convertible or renewal term products. Term assurance, where you know after a certain time period you can convert your term insurance to a permanent form of contract. Like you can convert it to say endowment or whole life assurance. You can also renew the original contract for a certain further period, and you might not necessary like it's not required to have further evidence of health status when you renew the original contract. This can be one option when we say renewable term assurance. And so these were like extended form of term insurance only, term insurance or say term assurance, which can be converted to whole life or endowment. Coming to annuity part, annuity can be either immediate or deferred. And immediate annuity involves it has single premium which you pay at the initial stage, and it can be purchased, it can convert to income stream which commences immediately in case of immediate annuity. And deferred annuity, it can be either single premium or regular premium. And the difference between immediate and deferred is, in deferred you have a time period between, there's a gap between the time you purchase the policy and the time when the payment starts, the income stream starts, which is the vesting date. So this is a major difference between immediate annuity and deferred annuity. Then the investment types, like the broad categories in which the products can be classified, are it can be without profit, with profit, unit linked, or index linked. So without profit is the one in which the benefit amount or the method of calculations are specified. In case of with profit, the company also shares the profit with the policy holder. So over and above the benefits defined, you also get certain proportion of the surplus of the company. That's the case in with profit products. Then coming to unit linked is like in this you have the benefits linked to your fund value, where the benefit depends on the investment returns during the period of investment. And there's an option to withdraw the fund also, but you might like the policy holder might have to pay a surrender penalty. This will be particularly at the early duration. The company needs to like company incurs expenses and all, so it has to recoup those expenses. So you might incur surrender penalties over there. There are you it will also have a guarantee offered on that, so that's an addition like over and above your fund value. It can be maximum of the sum assured defined or the fund value, the benefit over there. Index linked, it's in this index linked products or the segment over here, the benefits move in line with specified investments or say economic index. So that's a key difference over here. Then, so these are briefly the basic products of a life insurance company. You guys should also have some idea about the riders attached. So I know you guys have studied about these basic products in your CT5, but it's not I think it's very rare. You must have heard about the riders or say health products. And so health riders are also attachable to these base term products. So I'll just briefly tell you, it's not really required as a fresher, but anyways, just to give a brief idea. So there are riders which can be attached to your base products like critical insurance, critical illness insurance, where you get a cash sum on the diagnosis of certain critical illnesses. As those critical illnesses are defined in the policy document, which are priced for. You pay an extra premium for the riders. And there are cases where in the base products, these riders are inbuilt. So while the company prices the product, the cash flows or say the benefits of the extra benefit if in case of critical illness is already taken into account. So you are supposed to have brief idea. So critical illness, then you have accidental covers, there are terminal illness covers, and certain separate health products. Just briefly telling you, there are long-term care insurance products, then income protection, key person cover. So these can be more into the health insurance side, but just briefly telling you because we have riders also in the term products, which can be if you when you guys study SP2 and SP1. SP2 is more about the life insurance products, and there might be some description about these riders also. However, SP1 will also give you a good insight. So I just briefly explain these to you, and now I think I'll move on to what actuaries do and their role. Earlier I just mentioned about the brief product, like the products which actual companies, life insurance companies sell. And now the role of actuaries, like we work in multiple roles in life insurance also. There are various in the actuarial department also we have various sub teams. There are various specifications in which the actuaries work. So it's really common, like the most common ones are pricing, modeling, statutory reporting, shareholder reporting. These are the ones which you hear most frequently, I guess. And other than these also, actuaries work closely in product development, strategy development. We have a separate risk team. It can be the part of actuarial or as a separate department overall, which is also again it's actuaries play a major role in it. In risk team also you have there's close work with like actuaries work closely with the investment team. So actuaries have a very very wide role. We can fit into various departments in case of life insurance company. You'll also find actuarial people in financial planning and analysis team for that matter. And I think I should start with like explaining what actually is doing, say each of these teams. I'll start with pricing. So firstly, pricing can be done in using like any software. Like majorly it's done in Excel. The pricing is done in Excel models, or there are other softwares. It depends on company to company. And Excel VBA is very widely used in pricing. And when so the pricing team designs new products as well as reviews the existing products. And there are various factors which needs to be taken into account while pricing. Like firstly, you already know that like there are separate rates. Like there are different rates which needs to be charged to different types of policy holders. The rates varies from say ages, gender, smoker status, or say extra like smoker status, occupation class for that matter. So there are various considerations which needs to be taken into account while separating groups, like classifying groups, and then charging separate premium for each group, specifying separate premium for each group. Factors which needs to be taken into account while pricing, I'll say profitability. Firstly, company needs to decide what profit margin the company wants to keep for certain products. So that's a very big driving factor. Then marketability and competitiveness also drives it, because it depends like what the kind of competition the market, like if there are many insurance companies say selling vanilla term product, the price can be very competitive in that matter. The company might take a call to have it as a loss leader. It might charge very less for a certain product. It can use cross subsidy. If you don't know the word already, cross subsidy is in this case, I can say a company can charge less premium for a certain product, and the loss on that particular product can be compensated by another product in which the company can charge high premium. And like there are various factors which needs to be taken into account while deciding the prices and overall pricing for that matter. And other factors, like company also needs to take into account the risk characteristics of each product, the guarantees which the features the company can have in certain products, like the I think the capacity also matters a lot. The financial requirement, or say the financial capacity, capital capacity the company has, that really drives the prices. And the way the products are designed or priced, the features the company introduces. So these are driving factors. The distribution channels also really matter a lot, like which the company decides which products are to be sold by which distribution channels. And the commissions are also charged differently for each products, depending on how the product can be sold by each channel. And in this way, the commission varies quite a lot, and the prices also. Prices, it depends actually if it can vary at channel level or not. So, but it does really matter while pricing. And there are other things like, say, consistency with other products. Like, company needs to definitely consider the other products also. Say, if the company is trying to bring an innovative product, there's a high chance that people with existing policies, the existing policy holders might want to withdraw from the existing policy, they'll lapse, or say they'll surrender and then opt out for the new product, new policy. So this will really add up to the cost for the company. And like company incurs the expenses for reassigning those policies. So company needs to consider consistency with other products also. It also needs to build the administration system also. If there's any extra feature which needs to have the system have system changes, then it will add up to the cost. And accordingly, company will have to train these staffs also to sell the product or value those products. So these things roughly, broadly, I'll say, needs to be considered while pricing a product. Regulatory requirement is another like very important because you need to keep yourself up to date with the current regulation. What are the prerequisites and the requirements of the regulator? I think it will really be good for you people to go through the regulations. You'll find them on the IRDAI website, and going through the regulations, you'll get to know, you'll get some idea about the products and give more insight on how the pricing is done. And I think that there was a reason from you can go through the product regulation for that matter, to be specific over here. I'll move on to the modeling team side, like what the role of actuaries is in case of modeling team. So again, over here, it's very company specific. There are different softwares which different companies use. I think in life insurance, Indian life insurance, Profit is the widely used or mostly used software in case of life insurance. And the features of life insurance models, like it needs to, there are very various things which needs to taken into account in pricing, in modeling a profit, in modeling a life insurance work. So it needs to project the cash flows. When I say cash flows, it also need to include the discretionary benefits and the cost of setting up supervisory reserve and the required solvency capital needs to be allowed for. And also need to it for it's allow need to allow for in the order to calculate, you know, profits and all. The profit cash flows also needs to be very clear in the profit model. And if you have certain product features, like say when I mentioned up in pricing, company can add ex new features like options and guarantees. Those also needs to be priced in the software. So if a company uses profit model, it has to allow for each and every feature the product has. And in case of, you know, options and guarantees, it's likely that stochastic modeling facility will have to be built. For people who don't know what stochastic modeling is, like so you need to define parameters when you model anything, and there are certain values which you can assign to the parameters. There are cases like in cases of options and guarantees, you can't really assign one specific value to the parameters. So you need to have multiple values for each parameters, which can be monitored through the stochastic modeling. I think this will be more clear while you guys like work in the actuarial environment, and you'll hear quite a lot about stochastic modeling and dynamic modeling. So briefly, to sum up, the model should have all the cash flows. It needs to take into account all the features of the products to calculate the required results, like irrespective of it needs to take into account of all the cash flows of reserve, profit, solvency. Everything needs to be taken into account. So that's the main role of modeling team. Yeah. Then coming to the statutory reporting, over here, like again, the structure in of a statutory reporting in a life insurance company varies from company to company. And the main primary role of the statutory reporting team is it has its the requirements are more for the regulator. There are reports which goes to IRDA, and IRDA is our regulatory body, and valuation team plays a major role in delivering all the requirements. So key function areas, I'll classify them as reserving, experience analysis, as asset liability management, and in many companies with profit committee is also a part of statutory reporting. Again, this varies from company to company. each one of these segments, like reserving, experience analysis. Many companies have experience analysis as a separate team, ALM as a separate team, with profit as a separate team. Again, I'll just give this a disclaimer. It's not necessary that these come under the subhead of statutory reporting. Starting with reserving, based on the past claims, actuaries need to determine how much money the insurance company needs to set aside to meet the financial obligations and to stay profitable. So the liabilities are a prominent role, they play a key role in the financial statement. And actuaries in the reserving team provides the reserves to the financial finance team for that matter. And given that the future is very uncertain, the valuation standards are required to be prudent. Like the assumptions used in reserving are supposed to be prudent. So that, to make the chances of failing to meet the liability acceptably small. And this is where the experience analysis team comes into the role, deriving the assumptions, whether they are prudent or not. So that will come in the next segment. So the way, when I say reserving team calculates reserves, liability over here, the way it can be calculated, you can use gross premium valuation method to value the liabilities. Now, GPV method, which we commonly say, it can be either a formula-based approach or, cash flow approach. So both way, either way, the reserves can be calculated by the reserving team. Coming to the experience analysis part, the assumptions which the company uses, whether it be best estimate or the valuation assumptions, these are derived by the experience analysis team. They take into account the expected past liability and compare them with the actual liability, and then set up the new assumptions, which closely match up to the actual experience. So the liabilities should be based on the assumptions, which closely the assumptions should reflect the actual experience, right? The future, the projection should be based on the actual experience of company. So frequently the company needs to keep on revisiting these assumptions, like the actual experience the company has, and compare it with the existing assumptions to check if they still hold or not. That's where that's where the role of actuaries come. The analysis part of a year is really important, because certain assumptions are very sensitive to say profit or reserves. So their proper considerations needs to be taken while deriving the assumptions, while setting them. And over here, I can say the assumptions can be classified into economic assumptions and demographic assumptions. So in the economic assumptions part, you can have investment rate of return, inflation rates. And in the demographic part, you can have mortality, morbidity, lapses, surrenders, paid-ups. Paid-ups is, I think you guys must already know. So anyways, so demographic assumptions includes all of these. Broadly, you can sum up as persistency assumption, these lapses, surrenders, paid-ups as persistency assumptions. And these are reviewed frequently to check if they still hold or not. And one of the key role over here in the experience analysis is of the data which you use, or the actuarial department uses. Again, over here, there are many companies which have separate data department. And the data needs to be checked, for the credibility. And say whether you have sufficient data. When you set the assumptions, you classify your data into various subgroups. So say when you set the mortality assumption, you might want to, set the assumptions at specific levels, say different assumptions for male, female, smoker, non-smoker, of many such split for that matter. And you need to take into account the experience which you have, the actual experience on which the assumptions are going to be based, needs to be sufficient enough. It needs to be credible enough to base your experiences on. And so over here, the extensive checks are performed on data. That's also where actuaries play a major role. You guys already know garbage in, garbage out. So anything which is any experience which is not very credible will not give a correct estimate of future experience. So it's also a really key factor which needs to be considered in experience analysis. Then with profit, so with profit products, I already mentioned in with profit products over and above your defined benefits, you also get a discretionary benefit, like the policy holder gets a share of the company's surplus. So over here, how much surplus needs to be distributed or shared to the policy holder is determined by actuaries, like the bonus rates you call it, how much bonus you need to pay out this year, that needs to be derived at the end of year. And there are various things which needs to be considered while distributing the profit. Like you need to take into account the legislation, the company's own rule. Like many companies have their past practice, like established practices, and those really needs to be taken into account. And most important of all, policy holders' reasonable expectation. That's really, that drives the bonus rates, I'll say, because obviously when you sell the policy, you have set a certain expectation to the policy holder for the bonus or the surplus which you will be distributing to the policy holder. So you don't really want to disappoint the policy holder. So you have the policy holder reasonable expectation which you are supposed to meet. Like irrespect, like there might be situations where you are not able to meet. So everything needs to be taken into account, and this is a very extensive exercise, I'll say, over the year end, which is performed by with profit committee, and it can be part of statutory reporting team only. Next segment, I think I'll briefly explain. I think we're already running short of time. I will just summarize what the shareholder reporting team does. Like shareholder reporting, where it's responsible for, working on different metrics which are used to determine the profitability of the business which the company rides. And it really gives a good insight to the shareholders of the company of the business written and the growth of the company, the business growth. So the shareholder reporting team overall plays a key role in providing those informations to the respective shareholders and stakeholders for that matter. So broadly, we have embedded value team, VONB team, business planning team over here. The embedded value team, like I can define it as the value of the future profit stream from the company's overall business, the existing business. When I say existing business, all the business written till date, the value is derived, like the value of future profit stream, along with the value of the net assets. The net assets separately attributed to the shareholders. So these are like the two segments, the two parts, they overall make the embedded value. And the company regularly monitors the surplus or say embedded value of the team, as it gives a good insight to the shareholders. It really gives a realistic assessment of the value of the insurance company to the shareholders. So yeah, that's a key role over here in the shareholder reporting team. Coming to VONB, over here, it's the value of business written is over the it doesn't really value the entire existing business, just like we do in the embedded value. It focuses on the new business written over the new financial year. And take the pre so the value over here, by value I mean the present value of future profits allowing for the risk held. So yeah, in embedded value, we take into account the existing business till date. In VONB team, we only consider the business written in this financial year. Now coming to business planning. In business planning, the actuaries along with the financial planning team, we determine the business to be sold in the coming financial year, taking into account the company's profit criteria, many things like this, like profit criteria, capital requirement, financial condition of the company. And I'll say it's a very it's in business plan, it's very necessary to have the outlook of future. And like we really the business plan set helps to give sales target to the people. Like based on the company's business plan, there are various decisions which are taken. And that's where the actuaries play a very big role. And because the key decisions are based on the outputs or the results provided by the business plan team, it's a basic plan for the coming few years. Everything needs to be taken into account. And yeah, that's a really overall view of what the actuaries do in broadly each of the departments. And yeah, I think I'll just end it over here and leave the forum open to you all. If you want to know anything further, like apart from the types of products or what actuaries do, any specific questions on life insurance which you guys have to ask.
I would like to ask a question.
Sure.
Question is, as in, what is your advice for to the freshers, like how to enhance our CV profile in general?
Okay. So, I think as a fresher, firstly, you need to clear papers. You know, there's a misconception, I think, which many people have. I don't, at least in life insurance company, that doesn't really hold. People say that you should not have more than 4 or 5 papers at the initial stage of your career, otherwise you will face difficulty in finding job. At least I think, you know, in the life insurance so far I've seen, there's no such rule that you should have, you can't have more than 4 or 5 papers. In fact, I think at the initial stage, if you can clear as many papers as you can, it become your work life becomes easier. Like it's easy. It's you can focus on your concepts while working. You can focus on your on the job training rather than you know sitting and studying while working. So I think firstly focus on your papers. Do clear as many papers as you can. There are papers which help you in job, like initial few papers. I don't really think they have very much importance, but papers like CP2, CP3, SP series, like which are specific to your particular area of interest, these really help you in your job. So please, please do focus on papers. Secondly, try to improve on your IT skills, like learn Excel, like shortcuts, as many shortcuts as you can, because everyone knows Excel these days. Like you have actual papers in which you have to work on Excel. So I can't really say over here just have knowledge of Excel, but knowing the shortcuts which can help you do 1 hour job in 15 minutes is you know very beneficial. So learn as many shortcuts as you can. That's very beneficial. So do have good hands on Excel, maybe VBA, because pricing team or many other teams uses a lot of VBA. That will give you an added advantage, an edge over the others. Other skills, other softwares if you can, like Prophet, SQL, MS Access, MS, like overall SQL, MS Office, PPT. Many people you know really get stuck when you're asked to make good presentation. So these are things which you can prepare while you're working, while you're in your college. So please do focus on your IT skills, and if you can get training, like I remember when I was in college, I used to learn softwares like R software or say SQL. So like not SQL, I used to have good hands on MS Access. So these softwares do really matter in your job area. So please, please do get good hands on them. I hope I answered it. Like these were the two major advices from my side. Anyone else?
Good morning, ma'am. Am I audible?
Yeah, audible.
Yeah, so I have two questions. My first question is regarding a master's course. So, like, I have just graduated, I've done my BCom. So, can you suggest, is it necessary to do a master's course? And if it is, then, like, what master's course can complement an actuarial science career? So, that's my first question. And the second question is regarding like there are a few softwares that we learn during our papers, like Excel in CM1. So what other softwares can we learn outside our papers areas which are helpful in work experience?
Okay, so first answering your question regarding masters, I won't really say that it's a necessity, but obviously it adds value to your profile. You get to learn anything, like anything you will obviously learn anything in addition to what you have learned so far, right, when you go for masters. So it will obviously add to your profile, that's for sure, but it's not necessary as such, I'll say, because there's more of on the job training, and with experience you learn a lot, and the papers are also no less for you. First clear the 15 papers, I'll say. If you plan to go for masters in actuarial, there are many institutes, I think, there's CAS, Kent, many others, so those are there. From which, like, what's your graduation background, if I can ask?
So I've done BCom, and my specialization is business statistics. So, something related to statistics or actuary.
It actually depends on your area of interest. So, what drives you, that really matters. Just not for the sake of doing it. Like, don't follow what, like, others are doing just for the sake of doing it. If it interests you, I think you should go for it. And that's about the master's part. Secondly, I think you asked about softwares, right? So other than Excel, like you mentioned that you have Excel in your actual exams, please have a very good hand, like first get your hands on Excel. There are many things, you know, you can do in Excel. We get CVs where people write they're very good at Excel or have good proficiency in Excel, but when they do actually come to do an internship, say, with us, we really try to explain them simple functions. So it is, you know, it's not very, I'd say it's not really good. It doesn't give a good impression. So firstly, excel in what you already know. Like if you are doing Excel, ensure that you know in and out of Excel. So get good hands on Excel. There are different companies which use different softwares. I already mentioned SQL, SQL, MS Access, Profit. Profit, I think it will be difficult for you all to get your hands on because it requires license, and each license costs a lot. I think it's somewhere around 6-7 lakhs per license. So I'm not very sure if you can get your hands on Profit. That's definitely while on the job training, in which you can learn Profit. But otherwise, you can you know, all the codings are almost similar. Like if you know one, it will be really easy for you to debug the other. Like if you have in my case, like I had good hands on Access, MS Access. It was easy for me to get my hands on SQL because the codings are almost similar. Like I knew R software, so it's almost similar in each software. So you can, you know, get your hands on any software, like whatever possible option you have, please try to explore them. Because you never know now which industry you land up, which company you land up, which software they use. So at least try to make the most of each opportunity you have, each option available. Yeah, I hope I answered your questions.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
Good morning, ma'am. Is I'm audible?
Yeah. Hi, Chirag.
Ma'am, nowadays I have seen that in a freshers opening, many companies say if you have even one paper clear, you can apply for the job. So my question is, before entering into a corporate world, it is better to clear how much papers?
See, this is like this question, obviously I can't answer from one company's front, right? There are different companies which have different requirements, and the openings for which they hire are also different. So it varies from company to company. My personal opinion is try to clear as many papers as you can while you're in job, because while you're in your college, because it really becomes difficult to clear papers while you're working. So that's my personal opinion.
Like ma'am, this year I completed my graduation and till now I have two papers clear and I'm waiting for the result. I have given CM1 in September date. It is better for me to start job right now, or I should first clear at least four papers and then apply for any kind of job?
So it's obviously good for you to start exploring the job opportunity, because you get to learn a lot while working. On the job training is very different from the learning which you get from the papers, actual papers. And it, I think actually on the job experience is really different. So if you get to explore any opportunity, if there's any opportunity which you can exploit, do go for it. Regarding papers, try to clear more papers. And if you have cleared two papers till now, not a bad deal. You still have time left. You can clear papers while you're working. So I'll say just don't wait to, clear more papers and then apply for job. You can start exploring opportunities even now. Never too late.
Okay, thank you, ma'am.
Hello, ma'am.
Yeah, hi.
I want to ask that, where we can get more info about, you said what ALM and shareholders reporting. If you want to work at that department or that area.
You can read various articles. So ALM also, you have regulation on ALM. If you go to IRDA website, you'll find it. Regarding shareholder reporting team, you can search for the keywords. If you are really keen, you can take the material from anyone. Like if you can get SP2 material, that's for the life insurance in particular. Or life insurance paper also, I think it's a very general topic. You can study it from there. Search for keywords like embedded value, VNB, valuation of new business, business planning. You'll get a good insight of each of these.
Are there any internship opportunities in this area at first?
So it's again very company specific, depends. You will find these teams in most of the life insurance companies. And the opening depends on time to time. The requirement varies from time to time, so it depends on that. Anyways?
Ma'am, as I will complete my graduation in 2022 and I am appearing for first paper in 2022 April date. So after I cleared the paper, I should go for job opportunities or must we clear more papers?
As I already answered, I think previous few questions, it's never too late to, you can start working as soon as possible. If you get any opportunity, please do explore it, because you get a lot while working. You can clear papers while you're working. I know it's going to be difficult, but worth that effort. So please try to explore opportunities in the market.
Okay.
Even while you are in college, I think you're graduating next year, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. While working, while you're in college also, you can look for internship opportunities. Like I remember in my time, I worked in NIC while I was in college. It was a summer internship, and these days you have online options. So please try to exploit it and explore it as soon as possible.
Ma'am, can you get can you give more insight like how we can work in product development and strategy, like you said?
You can work. So your question is regarding applying for these areas or what these?
Yes. Like how can we prepare ourselves for what is the more work in this area?
again, like if you are really keen in these areas, search for them, like Google it, like you do your homework right before you ask anything. So first homework, search for it, and if even if you know you get stuck with it, we can connect anytime later. Yeah.
Okay.
I think we're almost done here. Anyone else, or if we can?
Last question.
Yeah.
You said that you've given three papers. Can I know which?
Yeah, so it was September 19 diet when I cleared SP2, CA2, CA3, all three of them in first attempt in one go.
I'm planning like within job, how?
I know I had to put a lot of extra effort, but it was worth it.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for such an insightful session. It was really very enlightening for all of us. The session has helped us to know a lot about networking, how to use LinkedIn, and about life insurance domain. Thanks a lot for sharing your journey with us. Being an actual aspirant, it was really very inspiring. Thank you.
Thank you so much for having me. It was really nice interacting with each one of you. Yeah, thank you so much.
Thank you.